From the studios of KPFA in Berkeley, this is Education Today. Good afternoon and welcome to Education Today. I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein. Today we'll be talking with Daria Bird, a graduate fellow with Education Pioneers. She began in 2010 working with the Education Pioneers, which she'll tell us a little bit about. This is a group that focuses on reform and giving support to urban education communities. Daria, before going to graduate school, worked in a range of capacities for several national nonprofit organizations. These include Facing History and Ourselves, Jumpstart, Building Excellent Schools, and Citizen Schools. These are all noteworthy organizations that are trying to develop schools in a direction that's more socially aware and community connected. And like many others in this generation, Daria went and did these projects before she went to graduate school, and so she has a great deal on which to base her work in the community and her graduate work. Most recently, she was a recruitment director for a teaching fellowship that connects recent college graduates to careers in education. Before we talk to her about her own intellectual and community work, I wanted to ask Daria to tell us just a bit about Education Pioneers, which is the organization that brought her to the Bay Area for this summer. And welcome to Education Today.
Thank you so much, Kitty. I appreciate you having me. So a little bit about Education Pioneers. It's a national nonprofit organization that's been around for about 7 years, and their mission is to bring talented leaders into education from a wide range of backgrounds. So they emphasize bringing people with policy, business, law, and as well as education skills, business into the education realm to use their skills in a way that those who may be trained as educators are doing a great job but don't have a wide range of skills, and they think that this sort of idea of hybrid leadership is really a model that can support educational change.
And so what do those people do once they're recruited?
So we're all part of a summer graduate fellowship, which involves sort of two main components. One is this cohort experience. So this summer in the Bay Area, there's 43 of us from graduate schools across the country who are doing workshops about issues related to urban education. So human capital, focusing on teacher recruitment and preparation. We've done out of school time where citizen schools came and talked to us about using the world outside of the school day, and other issues like race and class and urban education, how these are relevant. And then the other piece is that we get a 10-week summer placement project. So I'm actually placed with Education Pioneers this summer. So every fellow in the fellowship has this project that's sort of mission critical, something that the organization needs extra hands and minds on to help them figure out.
So you work for Education Pioneers, which is actually the core group that brought people together, but others work for other public and private agencies.
Exactly.
And can you say, what are a few of those agencies that they work for?
Sure. Some of the other fellows are working with an organization called the Foundation for College Education that's based out of East Palo Alto that focuses on sort of individualized support to get kids on the road to college. Another person works with an organization called Parents for Public Schools that really helps parents understand how the education system works and how they can have an active role in their community education-wise, and then also support their own students' education.
And what will those people who are doing these projects this summer be doing when they leave here and go back to wherever they came from?
Right. There's a range of things, actually. Some folks have just finished their graduate program before they start Education Pioneers. So in the best of situations, they find an opportunity this summer, and then we'll start working on that in the fall. Some people, like myself, are in the middle of their graduate program, so I'll be returning to school. And I think for the most part, it's either back to school or back to work. And actually, a few of our folks are a couple years out of graduate school and may have already been teachers, and they'll be returning to the classroom in the fall.
And I want to tell our listeners that, as always, in a few minutes, we'll give you the opportunity to call in and talk with our guests and discuss some of the issues that we're talking about. Our telephone number is 510-848-4425. That's 510-848-4425. You can hear our program every Friday, twice a month on Friday, on the second and fourth Fridays at 2:30 in the afternoon. And the programs are also available on the web at KPFA FM on the website, and you can listen to the archives of the Education Today programs. There are quite a few on there discussing a range of topics, and we've been told that we are an unusual program in that not that many programs on radio focus exclusively on education issues. So there might be a number of interesting topics you can find out about, including testing, issues about race and class and education, good teaching methods, international strategies, and so on. And pretty soon, in a few days, you'll be able to hear today's program also on an ongoing basis. So I'm wondering if you could say a little bit about the kinds of things, work you've been doing with Education Pioneers. And by the way, before you do that, I wanted to tell people also that Education Pioneers also has a website that you can check out. And if you Google Education Pioneers, you will be able to find out a little more about them. And if you know people who might be interested in this type of approach, they can find out the kind of work that the program is doing. So you've been doing a project with them. Do you want to say a little bit about that project?
Sure. I was brought on to work internally at Education Pioneers on what I'm calling a diversity strategy. And the idea was that the fellowship often doesn't represent all the folks who are in the classrooms. So the students, the families, and the communities, we want them to be better represented in the fellowship cohort. And the question was sort of, how do we do that? And what are Education Pioneers' beliefs about that? Why does it matter? Is race and class, sort of diversity in the context of the fellowship, important to the organization's mission and why? And so starting there, the question got a little bit broader, just so to understand what the organization itself believes about race and class and how that should be addressed in the organization broadly, and then how that trickles down into the fellowship.
So a lot of organizations are addressing this issue in some kind of form because, as we all know, a lot of organizations developed in the U.S. with cohorts that are not really representative of the diversity of the population, particularly in terms of economic diversity and ethnic diversity. So a lot of organizations that think about those issues take on a project of trying to figure out where they're at on that. And I think that's what you're helping them to do. So have you come up with any kind of thoughts? I know the project isn't finished and you haven't made a report on it, but does anything occur to you out of the process of doing that study?
Sure. One of the big questions that I think has come up is this a professional conversation where we talk about race and class and try to figure out what it means to the organization, or is this a personal conversation where I need to understand where I'm positioned and race and class and how it's played out in my particular perspective? And I think I came in thinking that that's something that you have to do both of. So in order to talk about where the organization should go and is going and how you're going to support that, you need to understand how your beliefs align with the organization's and how you're going to move that work forward. So I think that that's the one particular tension that's come up in sort of how people feel is the right way to approach this. Is it personal, which gets uncomfortable and sort of tense and people don't have skills or great facilitation to help them with that? Or is it just about the work? So that's been one big question. And then sort of, as you just mentioned, this idea of you start off your organization or your cohort experience with one sort of frame of what success and quality looks like. And then sort of down the road, when you feel like you've built your brand a little bit, you have a little bit more leeway. And just, I've been left with the question about whether or not that's the right way to go about developing an organization that's about social change.
So can you explain that a little bit more? How does the brand start out being framed, and then what kind of changes are you saying might be needed, or are you questioning the order in which these changes take place?
Right. So I think one of my personal frames is an emphasis on equity and access for folks who have not had it historically into sort of sites of power. So I think that one of the ways that the brand gets built that way is this idea that top schools, be they Ivy League or top tier, or, you know, I attend a Division I school for graduate school, that's where the smartest people end up. And I think if you're in the field of education reform and you acknowledge that there is not equal opportunity for students from all backgrounds, then you also have to acknowledge that the best and the brightest don't all end up at these top schools. So I think that the brand gets built that way when you sort of say, I want to sell my organization to someone, what's the easiest way? What will people automatically identify with high quality? That's strongly correlated with sort of the elite institutions in our country or the top schools and the names that most people know.
So when you advertise that you're getting people from the highest quality institutions, you're confirming the idea that there is something about those institutions that make the individuals in them the highest quality. But then if you turn around and say, yeah, but we don't have equity here, it sounds like you're agreeing that the highest quality people are at the high-tier institutions. But then what are you doing when you're trying to change the... And that seems to be actually an issue confronting a lot of education organizations. Teach for America, for example, advertises itself as recruiting from the, quote, elite institutions, but their cohorts have never represented the population of kids in the cities and rural communities that they're teaching in. So then the question is, why and what are you saying about the teachers who come from those communities? And so there does seem to be a tension there. So have you any thoughts or more thoughts or recommendations about that? Those issues just in general, maybe not just specific to your organization, but others as well.
I think one of the things is to look to models that aren't all successful in the same way. And I think, like you just mentioned, Teach for America, and I think one of the challenges there is that they've been particularly successful. So as I understand it, their teachers represent about 10 to 15% of the national teaching force, which is a from an organizational perspective, I'm sure they think it's not as big of an impact as they want to have. From my perspective, that seems to be a really weighty influence on the field. And so when you talk to younger organizations, many of them want to follow the TFA model. And then when you think about these challenges where their cohorts aren't representative of the community, is that the model that we should all be aligning behind? So I think being able to bring into the public eye other models and ways of going into communities. For example, I came across an organization called Partners for Developing Futures, which is intended to bring people of color and those from low-income backgrounds into the charter school field to develop and lead high-quality charter schools. And in conversation with Ref Rodriguez there, who is the executive director, it's sort of like they don't have this conversation at Partners for Developing Futures because their organization is built on the assumption that these folks from low-income backgrounds, people of color who have experienced the educational system, who have direct understanding of the communities, are best positioned to reflect the communities, be role models, but also to help solve the problems that those communities are facing in education and other realms. And I just think that's a powerful thing to remember, that you have to have a conversation about diversity when your organization isn't diverse.
And it's my experience, and this is, you know, anecdotal based on my own experience, but it's pretty extensive with quite a lot of organizations, that if you start out with an organization that is not representative, you never end up with one that actually is. You may end up getting a lot closer to 50%, but you never end up, in my experience, with an organization that's actually run by people of color, people from the community. So it is a real big organizational issue. And then, of course, in education, in the education field in particular, there's two dynamics of social justice. One is the education the kids get. The other is the employment possibilities for their parents, which disappear if you don't recruit from the community for these various educational endeavors. Then the parents of the children in the neighborhood don't have the benefit of being employed in what is actually the largest employment institution in many urban communities. Between education and healthcare, that's where a huge portion of the jobs are, because there aren't a lot of industry in many communities. So if you say, well, the kids would be better off if they had teachers who came from someplace else, maybe the kids would be better off if their parents had a job. That might be another dimension of it. So I don't know if that's something you think about also. I don't know.
I think that's a really interesting question, and I think it's also relevant in the nonprofit world, something I've seen at places where I've worked, where so the diversity is a parent of the one of the students in the program, or they have a parent who's on the board, but it's like there's all this sort of silent issues about race that's around that stuff. So why is it that when we have the parents of our students working in the organization, they're not at leadership levels, they're not engaged in like making critical decisions, but they might be the face, they might be the receptionist who's sort of answering the phones and transferring the mail around, which I think is important to have people involved. I think it's that critical, important sort of opportunity, which it's employment on one hand, but I think it's also like being involved in the kind of decisions that affect the community.
So I want to tell our listeners again that the telephone number, if you'd like to join us with either a question or a comment, is 510-848-4425. You're listening to KPFA FM in Berkeley, and the program is Education Today, 848-4425. So I think this issue of what quality is very, very complex, because we have a history in the United States of measuring quality essentially by tests. It's not, everybody says that's not the only measure they use, but the reality is the process from, kindergarten to a high-tier higher ed institution is a series of tests. There's a lot of other things in there. You write an essay, you get grades, but really it's a series of tests that move you forward from one to the next. And the history of testing in the United States is in the eugenics movement. So there's never been such a dramatic break with that form of testing that you would end up with having test scores that are parallel for the entire population in terms of. So it's not surprising that we end up when we take from a high-tier institution with a group of people that's not really particularly representative. And therefore, that's a question right there, right, if we should be doing that or not.
Right.
I'm interested in the organization you mentioned that has a different model of leadership development. I wish you'd say the name of it again, because I think people who are interested in this issue might want to check it out. You were talking about Ref Rodriguez's.
Ref Rodriguez is based in LA, and it's an organization called Partners for Developing Futures, and their focus is finding organizations and individuals who want to start charter schools specifically focused on minority folks and people from low-income backgrounds.
And this organization presumes that community experience and relevant background is a qualification,
right,
a high qualification, not just a subsidiary qualification,
right,
but a high
right
qualification. And that dynamic of how you analyze this, I think, is a really important one, and I'm very glad that you're studying it and thinking about it. Now, in your own graduate work, so you're going back to school and won't be in the Bay Area, but hopefully you'll be continue to be connected with us and we'll be informed by what you're studying. You've been studying something more on a related question of how of what the numbers of students of color who get degrees out of higher ed institutions and what affects that. Can
right
you say a little bit about your study?
Yes, definitely. And so the frame is this idea that over the last 10 years to 20 years has been this idea about college for all and success for all, and that idea that everyone should go to college so that the community college system developed. So it got to the point that getting into college was no longer the challenge. But then when you looked at the other side, that who's successful once they arrive, the numbers are sort of shockingly appalling, that students from low-income backgrounds, students of color, almost regardless of the institution, but obviously at the top, some of the top schools, that they're more prepared for that. But even at those schools, students who don't have financial need necessarily, students who are making the grade, sometimes are also those who are not being successful in the institution. So I was curious, based on my time at Citizen Schools, where I was doing recruitment for among college graduates, sort of why weren't there students of color coming to the table to talk to me about education at the same time that we were concerned about having a diverse teaching fellowship. So I sort of felt like, where are the students of color coming to this table? And so that got me interested in the idea of, like, okay, if kids are getting to college, what's happening once they arrive that's sort of having a negative effect on their success? And based on my personal experience in my 9 or so years working in organizations that were mostly run by sort of white, wealthy folks, I had, and having my personal experience of my voice being silenced on occasion, being critiqued for things that I feel like were more styles and cultural and preferences about how they wanted me to engage as opposed to actual challenges, I started to think about what role would the messages that an institution sends to students about who's valued on campus, what success looks like, the ways and behaviors that are accepted on a campus, how does that translate into a different opportunity and experience for students of color or those from low-income background, as opposed to the norm of what we think about when we sometimes say college, traditional college students? So that's a question that I'm trying to pursue in research I'm doing in school.
And are you studying at all the experience of the historically black colleges, which seem to be the institutions that do better with having high graduation rates,
right,
for especially for African-American students?
The project that I'm working on is actually based in Wisconsin, so I don't have the opportunity under this research project to study HBCUs. I think that I've come across some research in my time that sort of addresses some of that question. Obviously, some of it's this idea of community, sort of being really connected to your fellow students as well as to professors and to that community, and knowing that your school is there focused on your achievement, things that you can achieve really well. I have a friend who graduated from Howard University, and she said something to me about 10 years ago that stuck in my mind, which is this idea that she went to Howard and everyone was like, well, you're black, great, but what are you going to do? Like, who are you going to be? And I just sort of thought, well, I've never been in a social experience, let alone an academic experience, where, like, race was a non-issue.
Uh-huh.
And I think that that's probably a fairly powerful experience to be, sort of have that set aside and know that it's incredibly relevant and important, but it's not going to determine your opportunities and who you're going to become.
Hmm. Very interesting. Again, our phone number is 848-4425. We'd love to hear from you with either comments or questions. 510-848-4425. So where is your study taking you in terms of theories and conclusions? I know you're just in the middle of doing the study, but can you say a little bit more about what you're coming up with?
Sure. So there's a couple of researchers who've talked about the importance of social and academic integration in academic success, one of them being Vincent Tinto, who's fairly well known in the education field and research standpoint. And he's been critiqued by suggesting that the way for students to be successful requires them to leave behind what they bring to school, which is fine, perhaps, if what you leave behind is not that much different than what you'd get at school. So if you're talking about a white main middle class norm, then like the culture of home is not that different than the culture of school. And it's okay, fine, I integrate at school, not much of a challenge. But when you start to think about people who come from different cultural traditions, the idea that in order to be successful in this place, you have to leave yourself behind, I think is really problematic. So I'm sort of in that camp of trying to critique that idea and understanding sort of how is academic and social integration related to success and what are the factors that sort of determine that integration. So looking at, we've done interviews, I'm working on a project called the Wisconsin Scholars Longitudinal Study, and it's an experiment about the effect of financial aid on college graduation, and it involves all the public institutions in Wisconsin. So we have a control group and a treatment group of folks who've received the money or not via lottery, all among Pell Grant recipients. So we've had the opportunity, we have about 3,000 people who are receiving a survey every year and sort of keeping track with them. They're all outcomes, sort of health, social, family, school outcomes, the amount that they're sleeping, to see that if financial aid does have an effect, what are all the different ways that this could be going on.
Wow, that's a really exciting study.
Especially
the part about whether you get to sleep.
Yeah. The numbers are pretty scary. And then there's also, we have about 50 people in our qualitative sample who we speak with just about every semester and do in-depth interviews with. So I can draw from my personal question about this idea of like the institution's culture matching the student's culture or making room for the student's culture and how important that is. I get to draw on all this data to ask that question.
And how do you get at that question? I mean, I doubt if you just ask it directly, does this institution's culture match yours? I mean, a lot of people haven't thought about that. They
right.
haven't thought about either their culture or the institution's culture. So how
right.
do people go about thinking about that?
Well, we have a few questions on the survey that get at this idea of fit, which is something that comes up a lot in sort of higher ed research. And you can the student indicates whether or not they feel like they have a lot in common with their other peers, if they're just as smart as the other students that they're in class with, if they have good relationships with professors. So things like that, which aren't explicitly saying like I see myself this way and the school sees me this way, but sort of are people feeling connected and sort of what in what ways are they saying yes or no to that question? And then in the qualitative interviews, I think I'd be looking for, given that the data has already been collected, so I won't be asking specific questions about this, but I'd be looking for people's comments about how they feel on campus. So in a particular incident, when they sort of translate to me, this is what happened here, what do they tell me? How does the institution play a role in that? For example, I had a student who shared with me a story about a professor who said to her that you weren't at the exam, so I can't give you a grade, and you failed the class. Well, her name is on the sign-in book. She's the only black person in her class, so she knows she was there. The professor knows she was there. Everyone else was there. So how were they making meaning of that situation? Is that sort of, well, this one person had it out for me, or does this professor sort of represent what I think is happening on campus more widely in a more explicitly racialized context? So I think there's ways that you can just hear the different stories that students have to tell and try to understand what those are about.
And what do you know what happened to her?
She went to the dean and got it all worked out. And I think that what's interesting about this particular student is that she had a lot of what social capital is sort of what a popular phrase in education right now. But she has a mentor she got connected with the Boys and Girls Club, who was an administrator at the university that she attended. So she just had a lot of inside information, so she knew what to do. And I would think that many other students who came from a low-income background where parents are not college-educated, they don't understand how the system works, or that don't even feel that the system is there to work for them, and that wouldn't have been a student who went to a dean and tried to advocate for herself. So I think that it's worked out for her, but I think there are plenty of opportunities for it not to.
You've brought up a lot of interesting points in the last few minutes, and just one to resonate with one point. This issue of how you feel in an institution. I was just discussing this with somebody the other day that, I'm a cognitive person. I mean, I try to put things together in a mental way, but I also have an instinctive, intuitional feeling right. about a place that I've been. So I can walk onto a particular campus I've attended or taught at or whatever, and it has a warm feeling or a nasty feeling or whatever. And that's for me, who's a pretty empowered person. And I have all these instinctive, it's hard for me to make myself go places that right. feel bad to me. So for people who are not empowered, who don't have parents who know the way around the institution, all of those things, it seems like it would be very difficult even to show up at a place that feels bad, even if you can't identify every single thing that led to it not feeling like right. a warm place. Right. Is that the case? Yeah.
I think that that's a fair assumption. And there's a lot of research, particularly coming out of UCLA with Sylvia Hurtado's work on cultural climate and campus climate and the effect of, I think, in particular, attending really racialized environment. So either where you feel like you'd have a place, and it's either you don't have a place, you have a place that's sort of segregated off to the side, or you have a place that feels like fully integrated and that the messages you're getting are explicitly about race. I think that that's something that Sylvia Hurtado's work gets to. And I think that that's also part of what I'm interested in, is sort of organizational development and change. And like I sort of referred to my personal experience, is that people do their best work. Like, the research on teaching is that when kids feel connected and feel stimulated and engaged in the classroom, they'll do their best learning. Organizational behavior theory says that in a work environment where people feel connected and valued, they're going to do their best work. It's just sort of a no-brainer of humanness that I think gets left out. It doesn't have to be explicit, like racialized messages, but just this notion or this feeling that someone belongs here, but you're not that person. And I think that people get those messages a lot.
And there is not in the U.S. discussion about education reform really a lot about belongingness. And I've brought this up on this program before. Private institutions and other countries are more likely to explicitly talk about joy in learning, happiness in becoming educated, feeling good in a place, engagement. There's a new Gallup poll on how students feel, and they're asking a little bit of that question of whether students feel engaged or not. But it's not on the list of standards of what you're supposed to do in an institution. Nobody's measuring, as far as whether you should shut a school down or give it an award, whether people feel connected and belonging and joyful in that being a place to be. And I think that's important for everybody, certainly more important for those students who are feeling marginalized in the first place.
Right.
We only have a couple more minutes, but I would like to ask you to go back over a couple of the authors you mentioned that other people might be interested in. You talked about Tinto. Can you
yes.
say that name again? Maybe spell it in case
sure.
you are interested in.
His name is Vincent Tinto, T-I-N-T-O. He was writing probably in the 80s about sort of college success and has been critiqued by someone who I think is also really interesting. His name is William Tierney, T-I-E-R-N-E-Y. And why I think Bill Tierney is really interesting is he talks about power in this context, which is a concept I'm very interested in. Someone else I mentioned was Sylvia Hurtado, who works at UCLA and is a well-known professor and directs an institute called the Higher Education Research Institute, also at UCLA, and is sort of leading a significant charge on the research around college climate and its effect.
Great. And again, if you're interested in the organization that Daria is here working with this summer, it's Education Pioneers. So it's been wonderful to have you. I hope you'll come back as you continue your own studies and tell us more about the conclusions that you reach, very provocative topics that you're studying. And we very much appreciate you joining us on Education Today. I'd also like to thank our board op, Erica, and our producers, Kevin Cartwright and Jaron Epstein. And we will be talking with you again in 2 weeks at 2:30 on KPFA FM 94.1 in Berkeley at 2:30, second and fourth Fridays of the month. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Walking real hard and the bus cost too much, so I'ma just bike, 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 ride it, ride it, ride it.
Hey, my name is Nick, and that wasn't me just rapping. I'm an intern here at Cycles of Change Bike, relocated on 2289 International. Cycles of Change is a nonprofit dedicated to getting everyone affordable bikes. We have after-school bike programs, earn-a-bike programs, and more. Just as we give to our community, we rely on that same community spirit to keep us going. I'm here to encourage you to donate your old bike during our 100 Bikes in 100 Days bike drive that starts August 1st. Come join us.